morning.
Good morning.
Bob, you talked about petty lions. When I was in Tanzania 3 years ago, chieftain said for $200 you can pet his 12 lions. I chose to bypass that. I think I'll wait till heaven. And he said that, you know, if the lion snaps at you, just pop him in the nose. No, I'm not going to pop any lion in the nose. It's a beautiful day, isn't it?
Amen.
It's always a beautiful day when you're in the house of the Lord with God's people. And this is the great time here, isn't it? I hope you all had a wonderful Thanksgiving. Hope you had great fellowship, family, and friends. And this time of the year, when they start singing those Christmas carols, which they've been singing since Halloween, it's wonderful, isn't it?
Amen.
All those songs. And I imagine most of you are familiar with that song, O Holy Night. It was written in 1847. But what you may not know, what's rather ironic about that song, is that the church leaders didn't like it. They thought it was in poor taste. And had total absence of religion. I find it hard to believe. The first stanza goes like this: O holy night, I'll spare you by not seeing it. O holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin, error, pining. So the author of this amazing song invites us to close our eyes and to imagine the world before the birth of Jesus Christ. And he says, the latter part of that first stanza, that the world lay in sin and ever pining. Anybody know what the word pining means? I didn't look it up. It refers to wasting away of the human spirit as it grieves and endures pain. In other words, he paints a picture of the world in intense darkness, without light, a world of despair, and a world lacking hope. But then he adds three more words, till he appeared.
Amen.
And when Jesus appeared, everything changed. Amen?
Amen.
There was a president of a theological seminary that was meeting with the accreditation committee. And one of the members of the accreditation committee said, "Sir, what is the primary purpose of your seminary?" And he said, "The primary purpose of our seminary is to change the world." And the guy said, "Well, that's not what I was looking for." He said, "We understand that education is about making a difference, but what is the primary purpose of your institution?" And he responded, "To change the world." Isn't that the purpose of the Missionary Beach Church?
Amen.
To change the world? Isn't that the purpose of why we gave our lives to Jesus Christ? To be a change agent for good. That's why Jesus came. He came to change the world. And there's probably no other time of the year that reminds us more than the Christmas season that the world needs changing, that the world needs hope, that the world needs to experience the joy of having Christ in their heart. And I can't think of any other passage more powerful than this Philippians chapter 2. Which Paul talks about the glory of that holy night. Did you know that there is no other birth recorded after the record of the birth of Jesus? And you know there's no other lineage or family history given after Jesus? And in the Old Testament, from Genesis to the book of Malachi, is looking forward to the coming Messiah.
Amen.
Now, Paul doesn't give us any details of the birth of Jesus. He doesn't tell us about the wise men. He doesn't tell us about the shepherds, nor does he tell us about the angels singing glory to God in the highest. He leaves that to Matthew and Luke. But Paul introduces to us this theological concept. And I hope you have your Bibles open to Philippians chapter 2. So let this mind be in you, which is in Christ Jesus. And then in verse 6, Paul pulls back the curtain. The curtains of eternity. And shows us what took place before the Christ child was born. Verse 6, who being in the form of God did not consider robbery to be equal with God. Now the Greek word there, isis, is the word we get from the isosceles triangle. A triangle that's both sides are equal. Equal in size, quality, character, and number. Every day, every way, every aspect, Jesus is equal with the Father in every aspect.
Amen.
And Jesus knew his identity. He knew who he was. There are many people still wandering on earth trying to figure out who they are. In John 5:18, he says, therefore the Jews sought all the more to kill him because he not only broke the Sabbath, but he also said God was his Father, making himself equal with God. In verse 6 of Philippians chapter 2, Paul goes on to say, but being in the form of God. Now that word form comes from a Roman background. When a letter was being sent by a carrier, the king would take off his ring and press it into hot wax as a seal. And when he pulled his ring back, that hot wax had the exact representation of his insignia. Jesus is the exact image of the Father.
Amen.
Now, there's some people who view the Father as walking tall with a big stick. But God the Father is just as loving as Jesus, and Jesus is just as loving as the Father.
Amen.
Jesus said in John 10:30, I and my Father are one. And John 14:9, he said, he who has seen me has seen who? The Father. So what Paul is telling us is that even though Jesus laid aside his glory, and he took on the form of a bondservant, and he came into this world as a child, he never ceased being God. When Jesus became a man, there was no subtraction. He remained God in his fullness.
Amen.
There was a time when Jesus was God, but not man. But there never was a time when Jesus was man, but not God.
Amen.
Jesus never gave up his godlihood to become man. He was not part human and part divine. He was not a mixture of God and man. Instead, he was fully God the entire time when he was on this earth. When he became a man, there was not a subtraction, but an addition.
Man.
He took upon himself the human form. And he added humanity to his divinity. There he was, God and man, fully God. Because if Jesus was not God, then Christianity would just be a fable. Christmas would be a fable. And Jesus would be of no more value to us than Santa Claus. But because he is God, he is priceless. He is more than a man among men. He is more than the greatest of the great. He is God.
Yes.
And if the FBI had existed in the days of Jesus and they would have taken his fingerprints, they would have had the fingerprints of God the Father. So why is God telling us this in Philippians chapter 2? Why is Paul telling this about Jesus being God and taking the form and taking on humanity? Well, there's several reasons. We don't have time to go through all of them, but one of the reasons is that the Romans and the Jews despised the crucifixion. They despised the cross. And Paul is telling this Philippian audience about a God who was crucified. And secondly, there were many confusing views about the nature of Jesus. And Paul wanted them to understand what the Word of God said. And Paul understood that Romans and Jews struggled with the idea of worshiping a Messiah who was created unless they understood that he was God.
Amen.
Well, the Church of Philippi was originally a Roman garrison, and it became a Roman community. It was actually viewed as Rome away from Rome. And there was an overpowering cultural phenomenon in that community. It's called Curius Honorium, which means honorous. There's nothing terribly honorable about the race that they were in, but their race was to be number one, to do whatever they had to do to be the best, to be on top of the world. And that culture found its way into the Church of Philippi. And Paul is inviting them to recognize that that is not healthy. And that is not what Jesus represents. Today we would call that the me generation, or actually, it's now actually called it's all about me generation. That's the generation Paul is talking to almost 2,000 years ago, and we're still dealing with the me generation. It's only as we surrender to Christ and emulate Christ will we experience unity as a church.
Amen.
Because unity doesn't happen by preaching about unity. It's a result of people individually and corporately surrendering to Christ, serving one another, and emulating and glorifying Jesus. The more we behold his glory, his character, the more we become united as a church. Paul is telling us in Philippians chapter 2 that Jesus died for self-absorbed, self-glorifying people like us. And if we think we're not that way, look what happens at Christmas. Jesus rose on behalf and now empowers us to follow his example.
Amen.
To a people who said, number one is the most important, Paul is saying Jesus is the most important. And serving one another, servanthood is more important. Let me ask you this question. Do you ever have a hard time letting go of your possessions? Your house, your car, nice clothes, nice toys, electronics, iPads, iPhones, iWatches. Do you ever find it hard to relinquish your rights to be mad at someone for the good of preserving a relationship? That's servanthood. That's what Paul is inviting the Church of Philippi to experience. That's what Paul was inviting the New Samaritan church to experience. But as you ponder this, you also raise this question, why in the world did Jesus ever leave heaven to come to the grief of this earth? Why would he take up the cloak of humanity along with his deity, all to be known, all they had known for eternity was glory, honor, praise, and adoration? Why would he leave that to come to this? Where he'd be ridiculed, rejected, and crucified as a common criminal. Why do you think he did that?
Love.
Got it.
Yes. He did it because nobody else could do it. Because he did love us. He was the only one who could come into the sinful world and take sin away.
Amen.
Notice verse 8 of Philippians 2. Being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself. I don't know if we can ever fully understand or to put into human words the sacrifice that Jesus made for us.
Amen.
I read a parable once about a man called Walter. It's a poignant, it's a parable, not to be taken literally. Walter got a job at the largest corporation in the world, and he was told by the HR department he would have to start at the bottom in the mailroom. And one day when he was in the mailroom, and Walter loved his job, but he often thought about what it would be like to be the chairman of the board of the greatest institution in the world. And he saw this cockroach. And he did what most of us would do. He stepped over to step on it, and the cockroach said, "My name is Milton. Please don't step on me. Remember, it's a parable. I will give you whatever you want." He said, "Fine." That sounds like a fair deal. He says, "Maybe the vice president of this great corporation." Well, said it's done. Milton granted every wish that Walter had, until finally he was the chairman of the most powerful, most influential corporation in the world. He was on top of the world. He was excited. One day, his office was on top, he heard some noise on the roof, and he went out and he saw this young boy praying. And he said to him, "Are you praying to Walter?" The boy said, "No, sir, I'm praying to God." And that really bothered Walter. So he went back to his office and he commanded Milton to come. And he says, "I want to be like God." That sounds familiar. And Milton said, "Fine." The next morning, Walter woke up in the mailroom. Jesus left the penthouse to come to the mailroom to die for us. Verse 8, and being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. He left heaven to live among us. Not only to live among us, but to die for us. See, Jesus was God for us. He came to planet Earth as Emmanuel, God with us, that he might be God in us.
Hallelujah.
We have a God who suffered for us. He didn't just come to live, he came to die. And he didn't just die any kind of death. He died a terrible death. Jesus didn't come because he had to. He came because he wanted to. He did not come because he had an obligation. He came because he loved us.
Amen.
John 3:16, let's repeat it together. John 3:16, for God
so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son,
that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish. Thank you. Jesus came because he wanted to. He didn't die out of obligation. When the Father said to him, will you go to planet Earth? He said, yes. And he said, will you die for those people? He said, yes. But notice what Paul says about how he died. As even the death of the cross. He died as a common criminal. Now the Roman system of execution, the crucifixion, had been fine-tuned to produce the maximum amount of pain. Now, remember, I told you earlier, Roman citizens did not like the cross. In fact, if you were a Roman citizen and you were to be executed, it would not be by crucifixion. It would either be by suicide or by beheading. In fact, the word excruciating literally means out of the cross. And that word was created to help us understand the horror of crucifixion. It was not only a barbaric way of carrying out punishment, it was designed to bring total humiliating shame to the person being crucified. Crucifixion had not only the goal of killing a person, but degrading him while he was dying. The condemned person was often flogged, usually required to carry the beam upon which he was going to be hung. His clothes were parceled out to others so that he was hung naked in public. And once nailed to the cross, he was exhibited as powerless and for public entertainment. In other words, crucifixion meant death with great dishonor, with public degradation, and total shame. That's why in Hebrews 2:2 it says, Christ endured the cross, despising the shame. Many of you probably have heard of Dr. Death, Dr. Jack Kevorkian. He had an obscene obsession with watching people die. But you know what he said about Jesus? He said, I don't understand why he hung on a cross. If he would have died in my van, he would have died with respect. He would have died a dignified death. But Jesus did not come to this planet Earth to die a dignified death. He came to die a glorified death. Jesus died an initial death as the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. He died an official death as God's selected substitute. He died a judicial death, a judgment death for others. He died a sacrificial death, the just for the unjust, that we might be saved. He died a criminal death, so even his own heavenly Father had to turn away. That was the ultimate humiliation.
Amen.
If it had ended there at the cross, there would be no celebration of the birth of Jesus. If it had ended there at the cross, it would only be a bad memory. There would be no exaltation. You see, an ordinary baby is no cause for worldwide celebration. A dead Savior is not worthy of commemoration. But a risen Savior is.
Amen.
And Paul gives us the climax of this great passage in verse 9 when he says, therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name. Now that name above every name is not the name Jesus. If you lived in Palestine when Jesus was growing up, many people had that name. But there so often you'll see a baseball player whose name will be Jesus. So that was a common name. That was not the glorified name. Psalms 148 verse 13, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted His glory is above the earth and heaven. See, Jesus was born a man so that he could relate to us. He died as a Savior so that he could redeem us. He was raised as the Lord of lords that he might rule over us. And when Jesus comes back, he's not coming back to take sides. He's coming back to take control.
Amen.
Revelation 17, 14. These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them. For he is Lord of lords, King of kings, and those who are with him are called chosen and faithful. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, 5, preach Jesus Christ the Lord. So when someone asks you, are you a Christian? Yes. And why? Because of Jesus Christ. Because of Jesus. Romans 10, 9, you must confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. People want to know, does Christianity really work? And we need to be able to say, without hesitation, yes. I'm not the same that I once was. Philippians 2, verse 10, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven, and those of earth, and those under the earth. To bow the knee means to surrender. It is the act of humility. It is something you do when you're going to worship someone, to pay total homage to the person that is being honored. Paul makes it very clear that every knee will bow. Every knee above heaven, whether it be angels or men, every knee around us on earth, whether believer or unbeliever, every knee, whether it be devils or demons, everybody will bow in acknowledging the Lordship of Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Maybe you know the story of John Newton. He was a rough, dirty sailor with a foul mouth and a terrible appetite for rotten living. He hated life, and life hated him. But one day, someone gave him the book called The Imitation of Christ. He was also fortunate that a mother who, when he was young, told him about Jesus Christ. When he gave his life to Christ, he went all over London preaching about Jesus, sharing his testimony. Until his retirement age, he continued to preach. In fact, he needed an assistant to stand in the pulpit with him so he didn't fall. His voice was weak, and he was nearly blind. And while he was preaching, he said, Jesus Christ is precious. And repeated, Jesus Christ is precious. And his assistant said, but sir, you've already said that twice. And in a loud voice, he turned to his assistant. He said, I know I have said it twice. And I'm going to say it again. And I'm going to keep saying it. Jesus Christ is precious. You see, if the greatest thing we needed was information, God would have sent us an educator. If our greatest need had been technology, God would have sent us either a scientist or an IT person. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent us an entertainer. But our greatest need is forgiveness. And he sent us a Savior.
Amen.
Philippians 2, verse 11. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. To confess is to proclaim. And a day will come when every pagan tongue, every atheist tongue, every Buddhist tongue, every Muslim tongue, every humanist tongue, every demonic tongue will praise Jesus.
Amen.
Will glorify his name. And we will proclaim, it will all be done to the glory of God the Father. The purpose of the universe, the purpose of our existence, is to glorify him.
Yes.
And we will sing praises, and then we'll all sing.